Hi everyone, David Packer here, and in this video we're going to discuss the cosmic microwave background, the afterglow of the Big Bang. In particular, we're going to talk about how the cosmic microwave background was discovered, where does that come from, what do the fluctuations in this microwave background tell us about the makeup of the universe, and we're also going to discuss a different topic, the high Z supernovae. And what do they tell us about the accelerating universe, and how these measurements are related to the microwave background fluctuation measurements. Our story starts in the early 1960s at a Bell Labs installation in Holmdel, New Jersey. Bell Labs built this giant horn antenna, which was originally designed to test satellite communications. It was meant to detect signal bounced off satellites and back to Earth. Now, while this antenna was much smaller than other radio astronomy antennas, it had a very low noise floor. And for that reason, these two guys, Penzias and Wilson, decided to use it for astrophysical measurements. And in particular, what they wanted to do is they wanted to look for very weak signals, like emission by neutral hydrogen atoms, which would take advantage of the high sensitivity of the antenna and its amplification system. It was therefore their goal to eliminate all the possible noise from the antenna. But whatever they did, and wherever they pointed the antenna, they always got about 3.5 kelvins worth of noise in the antenna system. So they went ahead and tried to figure out where the noise was coming from, and tried to eliminate all possible sources of noise. Was the noise coming somehow from the antenna itself or from the amplification system? After extensive calibration, they figured out that no, it wasn't. It must be extrinsic. Was the noise coming from human-made sources? Well, being in New Jersey, they had a giant human-made source right next to them. They pointed their antenna right at New York City and didn't see any appreciable increase in noise, indicating that it was probably not human-made sources. Was the noise coming from the atmosphere of the Earth? Well, to try to figure this out, what they did is they took their antenna and pointed it in different directions. So they swept it from being pointed straight up to being pointed towards the horizon. Now, the expectation is that as you sweep the direction of the antenna, you see different amounts of atmosphere and therefore different amounts of noise. They went ahead and took into account this varying amount of noise from the atmosphere, figured out that there still was excess noise. The next culprit to consider was a pair of pigeons who made a home inside the antenna and left their droppings there. The pigeons were evicted, the droppings were removed, but the noise did not go away. At this point, Penzias and Wilson started looking to the sky. Was the noise coming from our own Milky Way galaxy, or perhaps from some sort of point sources? Pointing their antenna in various directions, they figured out that the noise was uniformly from all over the sky and wasn't coming from any particular direction. Having eliminated all the sources of noise that Penzias and Wilson could fathom, the only remaining conclusion was the universe itself was making noise from all directions. Meanwhile, in a university not so far away, the Princeton team was hatching a plan. Dickey, Peebles, Roll, and Wilkinson had a theory about the cosmic microwave background. Their theory was actually a rediscovery of earlier work by Gamow, Alpher, and Hermann. Anyway, so where does the cosmic microwave background come from? The early universe was extremely hot. It was so hot that matter was in the form of a plasma. The picture on the left shows a plasma inside a tokamak, a fusion reactor. As you can see, the plasma is not transparent. That is because in plasma, the electrons and nuclei are traveling separately and they're really good at scattering light waves. As the universe expanded, it cooled. At some point, it reached the temperature of recombination, about 3000 degrees Kelvin, at which the nuclei and the electrons recombined into atoms. Once recombination happened, the universe became transparent to light and became what we see today in the picture on the right. Now, this transition from opaque universe to transparent universe is very similar to the transition that happens in a glass of diluted milk. As we all know, milk is opaque, as it appears in the vial on the bottom left. As we add more and more water, diluting the milk suddenly has a transition where it goes from opaque to transparent. And that is exactly the same thing that happened to the universe in the age of recombination. Before recombination, light and matter were strongly coupled and were at the same temperature. At the epoch of recombination, light and matter were both at the temperature of about 3000 degrees, which translates to basically visible light. Following recombination, light and matter decoupled. As the universe expanded about a thousandfold, the visible light at the age of recombination turned into microwave light in the present universe. In 1964, Princeton team was setting up their own experiment to try to look for the microwave background that their theories predicted. At the time, Penzias came to know of Dickey and his team through a mutual connection at MIT, and therefore Penzias went ahead and called Dickey. The two of them quickly realized that the excess noise that was being observed by the Bell Labs team was exactly the microwave background predicted by the Princeton team. At this point, Dickey announced to his team, "Boys, we have been scooped." Within several months, the two teams wrote up a theory and an experiment paper and published them back to back. For their work on the cosmic microwave background, Penzias and Wilson went on to win the 1978 Nobel Prize. Peebles won a Nobel Prize in 2019 for his contributions to physical cosmology, including the cosmic microwave background, of course. What does a cosmic microwave background sound like? Let's go ahead and take a listen to an audio recording back from back in the day, narrated by Robert Wilson himself.
This is Bob Wilson of Bell Laboratories. The noise you're listening to in the left channel is noise from a radio astronomy receiver on the 20-foot Hornet reflector antenna. This is the original instrument with which Arno Penzias and I discovered the cosmic microwave background radiation in 1965.
To conclude the story of the cosmic microwave background, let's take a quick look at this document. This is a news release from Bell Telephone Laboratories, where both Wilson and Penzias worked. What is so unusual to our modern eyes is that back in the day, Bell Labs and many other private institutions actually supported basic scientific research. Indeed, Bell Labs made quite a few discoveries which has changed our modern world, including the discovery of the photovoltaic cell by Russell Ohl. This is, of course, the basis for our solar panels, which generate electricity from sunlight, and the discovery of the transistor by Bardeen, Bratan, and Shockley. And as you know, the transistor is a basis for all our modern microelectronics, like computers and cell phones. Bell Labs was also responsible for the development of both C and C++ computer programming languages, which are still widely used today. It is an interesting question whether private industry will go back to the golden age of supporting basic scientific research and reaping the many rewards from that research. Now, what have we discovered about the cosmic microwave background since the 60s? Well, using a series of satellite missions and also high-altitude balloons, scientists observed that the cosmic microwave background was not perfectly uniform. Instead, it had tiny fluctuations, about one part in 100,000. And every new generation of observation satellites, from COBE to WMAP to Planck, mapped out these fluctuations with ever-increasing detail. Now, these fluctuations tell us about the fluctuations that were present in the very early universe. Over time, powered by gravity, these initial tiny fluctuations turned into galaxies and clusters of galaxies, which we see throughout the universe today. And therefore, scientists are quite interested in studying these fluctuations because they tell us about the structure of our universe. Taking a look at the all-sky map of the cosmic microwave background fluctuations shown on the left, we see that there is structure at different scales. Now, how do we analyze this? Well, what we do is we plot what's called a power spectrum. For the engineers among you, this is basically a Fourier transform, but using angular harmonics as opposed to sines and cosines. The power spectrum is plotted on the right, and it shows how much fluctuation intensity there is at different angular length scales. For example, we see that there is a big peak somewhere between 2 degrees and half a degree. Now, here also is a nice blurb from the Berkeley Cosmological Essays, which tells us how to interpret these peaks. It says, the shape of this power spectrum is determined by oscillations in the hot gas of the early universe, and the resonant frequencies and amplitudes of these oscillations. That is, which notes the universe likes to play are determined by its composition. Since we know the physics of hot gases very well, we can compute the properties of the oscillating gas by studying the positions and the relative sizes of these peaks. The position of the first peak, for example, tells us about the curvature of the universe, and hence how much total stuff there is in it, while the ratio of the heights between the first and second peak tells us how much of the matter is baryonic, ordinary matter, and of course, how much of the matter is dark matter. In practice, there are many variables that affect all parts of the power spectrum, and detailed computer simulations, the red curve in the plot, are used to sort it all out. Now, what do we find? Well, here's a pie chart showing the composition of our universe, as inferred from the cosmic microwave background fluctuation data. It turns out that ordinary matter makes up only 4.6% of the universe. 24% of the universe is made up of what's called dark matter. Dark matter interacts gravitationally, just like ordinary matter, but we can't see the dark matter, and hence it's called dark matter. This invisible dark matter is not only responsible for how the universe expands and slows down, it's also responsible for holding galaxies together, a point to which we will come back. Now, the vast remaining majority of the universe, 71.4%, is composed of what's called dark energy. This is Einstein's cosmological constant, and you can really think about it as an anti-gravitational force which is causing the universe expansion to accelerate. While there are many ideas that scientists have about what dark matter and dark energy are made of, none of these ideas have been verified by any sort of experiment. And therefore, while we know that the majority of the universe must be composed of dark matter and dark energy, we don't really know what those entities are. However, we have independent observations of both. We begin by discussing dark matter. Here is shown an image of a typical galaxy, and overlaid on top of that is the velocity of the stars inside the galaxy. Now, it turns out that if we add up all the masses of the stars and dust clouds in the galaxy, there's just not enough mass to make the galaxy move as it appears to move. Specifically, the measured velocity of the stars in the outer part of the galaxy is much, much higher than what we expect from the matter that is observed in telescopes. To resolve this discrepancy, astronomers hypothesize that galaxies have a lot of what's called dark matter, which is matter that is holding these galaxies together, but it is invisible to our instruments. Now, the gravitation from dark matter doesn't just hold galaxies together, it also bends light. Here on the left is an image from the Hubble Space Telescope showing gravitational lensing of this blue galaxy by the cluster of galaxies in the middle. The multiple images of the blue galaxy are indicated by the arrows. Now, estimating the mass of the galactic cluster in the middle, turns out that it doesn't have quite enough mass to bend light as we see it. Indeed, the image on the right shows a calculated distribution of dark matter that is needed to bend the light, like we see it in the image on the left. The dark matter density is indicated by the intensity of the blue hue. So, to summarize, dark matter is in many ways like ordinary matter in that it causes attractive gravitational forces. However, unlike ordinary matter, we don't actually see it, and we have no idea how to interact with it. and that is why we call it dark. Now let's switch gears and discuss dark energy. Integral to the story of dark energy are type 1a supernovae, like the one in the bottom left corner of this Hubble Space Telescope picture. Now, what is so special about a type 1a supernovae? A type 1a supernovae happens when a dead star, a white dwarf, has a companion star. The white dwarf is a little white dot in the top right, and the companion star is a balloon-shaped blue thing in the bottom left. The white dwarf accretes material slowly from the companion star, and as it does so, it builds up mass. Once the mass of the white dwarf reaches about 1.44 solar masses, the pressure and temperature inside the core of the white dwarf has built up enough to start off carbon fusion. Carbon fusion turns into a runaway process, causing the star to blow apart in about 1 second, as the simulation shows. The key property of type 1a supernovae is that the mass of the white dwarf builds up slowly to the critical mass, at which point the white dwarf explodes. Why this is important is because all these explosions happen at about the same mass, and therefore they're all about the same size. And therefore, they all have approximately the same luminosity. Which means this particular type of supernovae can be used as a standard candle to determine distances to faraway galaxies. How does this distance measure work? Well, first we use parallax to measure distance to nearby Cepheid variable stars. This allows us to calibrate how much light Cepheid variable stars put out and turn them into standard candles. Next, we use Cepheid variable stars to measure distances to nearby galaxies. Next, we look for type 1a supernovae explosions in these nearby galaxies, and therefore we can use the Cepheid distance to calibrate the type 1a supernovae distance. Now, because type 1a supernovae are really bright, we can use them to measure distances to really, really far away galaxies. And that is exactly what two independent teams, the Supernova Cosmology Project and the HiZ Supernova Search Team, did back in 1998. Now, using the type 1a supernova distance, combined with the redshift of the faraway galaxies, these two teams were able to establish the Hubble curve, but also extended to very large redshifts or really, really faraway galaxies. Now, of course, when making plots, things tend to get topsy-turvy, so here the redshift called Z is plotted on the horizontal axis, as opposed to the vertical axis like we had it before, and the distance is plotted on the vertical axis. The important point is that we are expecting essentially a straight line following Hubble law. However, we see that data does not lie on a straight line. Instead, data lies on a line which is curving slightly upwards, indicating that the universe is accelerating its expansion, and this data is well fitted by a cosmological model with 70% of the universe made up of dark energy. Now, to summarize these findings, let's take a quick look at the brief history of life, universe, and everything. This plot shows the birth of the universe 13.8 billion years ago. I suppose this plot is slightly out of date, as the current best estimate is 13.7 billion years ago. The age of recombination, which happened 375,000 years after the Big Bang, is not shown on this plot. Soon thereafter, the earliest stars and galaxies are formed, and now there is light in the universe coming from these new stars. The light from these early stars can ionize atoms in the early universe, and hence this is called the age of reionization. Our own Milky Way galaxy is formed about 9 billion years ago. At 4.5 billion years ago, our solar system is formed. Soon thereafter, 4 billion years ago, earliest life forms appear on Earth. Now the cosmological data from the type 1a supernovae indicates that just before the solar system is formed, about 5 billion years ago, the universe starts accelerated expansion due, presumably, to the dark energy component. Here is another picture depicting the growth of our universe since the beginning of time, since the Big Bang on the left-hand side of the picture. Notice that since the time of recombination, which is labeled the afterglow light pattern, 375,000 years, the universe has been extending rather steadily, except about halfway through this expansion, the universe expansion starts to speed up. And this is exactly the dark energy acceleration that we are talking about. We will save the discussion of quantum fluctuations and inflation for another time, as I think we have already covered quite enough topics in this video. Perhaps the most earth-shattering concept that we talked about is the composition of the universe. Coming back to this picture showing the composition, we see that the bulk of the universe is made out of dark matter and dark energy, two components that we really don't understand and can't see, but we can certainly measure their effects. Thank you for watching the video, and remember to stay curious.